Am I on? Yes. So you see me. I studied Pastor Kevin. Mic is down. I do understand why he always needs water. I always thought, why is this guy, the guy drinks water, but I'm dry already. So anyways, how's everybody this morning? Happy New Year. I get to say it from the pulpit. I don't have to text you personal, which is great. I hope you all had a good evening. This morning, it was terrible. I woke up this morning and I found out this Minnetonka's water, it shrunk all my clothing. I wouldn't fit. So I had to find certain clothes that I would even fit in. So this thing is about 10 years old. And that's for that. I'm going to start with prayer and then we go right into the sermon. Thank you, Lord, for this morning. We thank you that we can gather here together. We thank you that we can hear a word from you, and I ask you to give me strength and everything I need to preach what you want me to preach. And I pray that you would open the hearts and minds of everybody, including my own, that we receive the word from you, that we can grow in what you have to teach us. Amen. So today's sermon is called, I Don't Get What I Deserve. I don't get what I deserve. We hear that phrase a lot in today's world. People use this sentence in different contexts like, I didn't get the job I deserve. I didn't get the partner I deserve. I don't get paid what I deserve. I don't get the education I deserve. It's about me, myself, and I, and the deserving attitude we have. Today we're going to look at what the Bible says about what we deserve. We're going to see what the world says what we deserve and what we think what we deserve. Here's what the world has to say about what we deserve. Motivational speaker Tony Robbins says this: what we get in life is completely unrelated to how deserving we are. We all know people who are at the epitome of kindness and goodness and who can't seem to get ahead. We also know people who are lazy and selfish and seem to get everything they want. The first rule of life is it doesn't owe you anything. To get what you deserve, you need to live with an open mindset and a positive mindset. You must hold a deep belief that you truly deserve good things, which is interesting, and you need to be willing to work for them. We heard the scripture that Carson read here in the Bible, and I think it's clear what the Bible says what we deserve. We deserve punishment, we deserve hell because of the sins and trespasses we're in. Now that we know what the world said about what we deserve and what the Bible says what we deserve, we could just call it a day and we'll go home and I'll be done. No, of course not. Today we're going to look at a parable of a father and two sons who thought they deserve good things. We read the story in Luke 15, 11 to 32. This is Jesus telling the story. And he said, there was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And here he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country, who sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long ways off, his father saw him and felt compassion, and ran and embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. and bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to celebrate. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, "Your brother has come, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has received him back safe and sound." But he was angry and refused to go in. His father came out and entreated him. But he answered his father, "Look, these many years I have served you, and I've never disobeyed your command. Yet you never gave me a young goat that I might celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours came, who has devoured your property with prostitutes, you killed the fattened calf for him." And he said to him, "Son, you're always with me, and all that is mine is yours. It was fitting to celebrate and to be glad, for this your brother was dead and is alive. He was lost and is found." To understand the story, we're going to look at first the younger son who thinks he deserves his inheritance now. Second, the older brother who thinks he deserves it because of his hard work. Third, the father who is compassionate and merciful and gracious. Later we will discover what the parable means, which brother are you in the story, and what we can learn from the attitudes and mistakes from the two brothers. This is a very interesting passage, a parable with multiple perspectives to look at. First, we see a man that has two sons, where one day the younger one demands his inheritance. One author describes the situation like this: "He divided unto them his living, his property or means of living. The division of property among the Jews gave the older twice as much as the younger. In this case, it seems the younger son received only money or movable property, and the older chose to remain with the father and dwell on the paternal estate. The lands and fixed property remained in their possession. Among the ancient Romans, and I hope I say this right, Syrophoenicians, it was customary when a son came to the years of maturity, if he demanded his part of the inheritance, for the father to give it to him. This the son might claim by law. It is possible that such a custom may have prevailed among the Jews, and that our Savior refers to some such demand made by the young man. He thinks he deserves the inheritance now. He wants it, and his plans aren't to go on his own or buy farmland or invest it and make money with it. Instead, his plans are to blow it with partying, prostitutes, and everything else a sinful heart desires. One author said this: "Give me the part of goods that falleth to me. See the root of all sin, a desire of disposing ourselves of independency on God." I believe the biggest struggle for any person is to be wanting like God. We want to be like God. Satan wanted to be God, and he got kicked out of heaven. Adam and Eve wanted to be like God, knowing what is good and evil. We all want to be our own little gods in our own little world, and we want to be independent. Some of us want to live off-grid and not depending on the system. Some, they want to make a lot of money so they can do what they want to do. As Warren Buffett said, money is a tool that lets you do that. The sinful nature of man wants to be something. We want to be our own God, and we want to be in control of our lives. If you drive into Swan River, there's a sign that advertises, "My education, my way." Frank Sinatra's hit "My Way" is a song about self-determination, living and on our own terms. We see in history with many kings and dictators, at some point it's not about the wealth anymore. It's not about the money. It's about glory, to the point where they want to be worshipped as gods. For example, Nebuchadnezzar, he made a golden statue of himself to be worshipped. The pharaohs were worshipped as gods. The belief of the lie of the devil, "You can be like God," is what we see throughout history and in today's world. Even some of the charismatic churches teach you can be a little God, and you can declare and call things into existence. Now back to our story. Once he blew all the money, a famine arose and he was looking for a job. It sounds like that guy that won the jackpot, $50 million, and he was broker after a year and a half than he had when he got the $50 million. He was so desperate that he got hired on as a pig farmer. That was the most humiliating thing for a Jew. One author put it this way: this was a job forbidden to the Jew. Cursed is the man that feeds the swine. He longed for food of the pigs. I always thought that was the ugliest part of the whole story when I was a kid. I just couldn't imagine how a guy wanted what these pigs eat. I don't know if you've ever seen what pigs eat, but it's nasty. I didn't know how much of a no-go that was at the time for Jews to even be close to pigs. Once he came to himself in hunger and agony, he decided to take a chance and go home to his father. He thought to ask for forgiveness and that maybe he would be hired as a servant so he could at least eat and not starve. As he was still far away and probably thinking about how good are the odds for me to be taken back as a servant, his father sees him still far away and feels compassion for him. He runs to him before he could even ask for forgiveness, and he had compassion and embraced his son coming back. When the father reached the son and he apologized and said, "I've sinned against heaven and before you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son." The father wouldn't even let him finish the sentence and gave orders to bring clothes and shoes. One author commented this: shoes on the feet were significant because the slaves were never given shoes, only the family members, the son. Slaves were never given shoes by their masters. That is why that old Negro spiritual that came out of the slave days, "You got a shoes, I got a shoes, all God's children got shoes. When we get to heaven, gonna put on our shoes. I'm not going to be a slave anymore. I'm a son. I'm a child of God." And that hymn looked forward to that day when they would have shoes. They would be acclaimed the sons of God in that heavenly kingdom. That was just one thing about slaves, slavery. You never gave your slave a pair of shoes. So the son said, "Hey, I'm not worthy to be called your son, just a servant." And dad didn't even let him finish the speech. He said, "Put the shoes on him right now." Then the father throws this huge party to celebrate the lost son with the fattened calf and music and dancing. The older son comes home totally surprised, like, what's going on here? Once he finds out it's because his useless brother is back home, he gets really mad. Rather than be super happy that his lost brother is back and found, here's a little illustration I wrote down to make this more clear to understand the older brother, why he's so mad. Imagine there's a window installer business, a father with two sons. The business is worth, we're making this up, $1 million with the shop, all the equipment and assets. The business also has $100,000 cash in their bank account. So the father has 50% of the shares and the two sons, 25 each. So one fine day, the younger brother says, who worked the least so far, tells his dad, "I'm sick and tired of this heavy lifting, these windows around, and in general, all that hard work. Every day, sun up till sun down, I'm done with this. I want to pull my share out of the company." Dad agrees to it, which means he gets $250,000. So dad goes to the bank, and he drains that $100,000, which they saved up, and he goes and takes another $150,000 line of credit at over 10% interest, and he hands the money over to the younger son. The older son has to watch all this from the side. What is going on here? He sees that $150,000 at 10% interest. He knows what that means. He knows how he has to bust his back because of this foolish decision his younger brother made. Now, if that's not enough, he works hard and he pays all this debt back, and it took him 2 years. Now, just as he came out of the red last week, guess what? And despite all the crazy inflation and bad markets and economies, no good. Well, now imagine who shows up, his younger brother. And on top of all that, then dad orders $20,000 worth of food at the meat packer. They're throwing this huge party. He says, Alan Jackson, you got to come. I need you for music and dance, which is another $100,000. And here, this older brother just gets a heart attack because he sees, well, what is dad doing? He's doing it again, throwing all that money out the window. He's so mad after he worked so hard, his useless brother showed up, and dad does it again. I think the older brother would have preferred that his younger brother would be dead. Do you sometimes have thoughts that a person was rather dead? In this parable, we see how Jesus talks about God the Father, the Pharisees, who are the older brother. From my understanding, I think the younger brother is the Gentiles. It could be sinners in general, or it could be Jesus talking about Jews that are backslid or sinned and turned from God and came back. We don't know exactly, or I don't know. If you look at the older brother in the story, who represents the Pharisee, the Jews were the chosen ones by God. With that, some were extremely prideful. They thought they deserved salvation and God's love. In Luke chapter 7, we can see the attitude the Pharisee had towards sinners and Gentiles, which the younger brother represents. In Luke 7, verse 39, now when the Pharisee who had invited him, that's the Pharisee who invited Jesus, he said to himself, if this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is and who is touching him, for she is a sinner. A little later, Jesus lectured this attitude. In verse 44, we read, then turning towards the woman, he said to Simon the Pharisee, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I'll tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For she loved much, but he who is forgiven little loves little. This story reflects the older brother very good. He thought so high of himself that he has no mercy on his younger brother, totally forgetting that he's not perfect either. This is true and very challenging for us as church as well. We are not perfect, and we need to forgive each other. If we learn and realize how evil we are and how much Jesus forgave us, the more we can start to forgive and love others. But first, we have to experience that in ourselves. So who here does New Year's resolution? Anybody? I don't, because I usually, 2 weeks into it, I forget and I quit. And so whether we do or we don't, this is my hope and wish for everybody as a New Year's resolution, to ask God to show you how evil your heart is and how much He forgave you in your personal life so you can be able to forgive others. And this applies to myself, certainly. That's our challenge for this year, to continue to grow in grace and forgive one another and to love each other like Christ loves us. We will talk in a minute how this is possible. To see how God the Father has compassion and provides a way for the Gentiles and sinners, which is us too, to receive salvation and make them equal with the Jews, probably hurt their pride. Like we said earlier, the younger son in the story, it could be the Jews or the sinner in general. Which of the two brothers are you in the story? I think we can find ourselves in the actions or behaviors of the older and younger brother. I certainly do. So if you are the younger brother that thinks he deserves everything and is on the way to the world, or on the way into destruction and sin, turn around to God now. It is foolish and dangerous to continue dabbling with sin and toy with sin. If you are in sin already or struggle with sin, don't hesitate or think God will only accept you back as a servant, or He may not accept you at all. Maybe you think you went too far, that God can't forgive you anymore. He will forgive you over and over and over and over again. as long as you repent and you're sincere about it. His grace is not a license to sin and then just say a quick prayer and trying to get our sin account reset. God forgives and forgets. He doesn't hold it against you. And if we forgive, we should forget too and not hold record of sins. For example, this gets funny maybe, if I truly forgive my wife for something, I don't pull up old things and hold it against her every time we have an argument. Although when the gas tank is empty, it is really frustrating. Especially if you say it 10,000 times, but there's lots I do wrong, so there's no bad. It's fine. If you're the older brother in the story, the danger I see is your self-righteousness. You're full of pride and arrogance. If you have a hard time showing grace towards others, other people, whether in the church or outside of the church, whether it's your spouse, family, or siblings, if it's hard for you to forgive and show compassion to others as you think you're such a good Christian, God didn't have to forgive you much, is what you think. Stop thinking you're righteous because of your achievements. Maybe you even believe you have achieved great things for God. Maybe you look down on your brother and think, I'm not bad. I don't smoke. I don't drink. I'm a good person. I didn't leave the Father and spend all my inheritance with prostitutes and booze. It was Him. Maybe you think God is proud of you and of what you've done for Him. If this is you, you're just as foolish as the younger brother, and you're not one bit better. I don't say this lightly, and I'm preaching this also to myself, but my hope is that you wake up and repent before God. We will talk a little later about the good news that God has a perfect solution for you and for me. Maybe that was too early. Now that we know what to do and what not to do, here's the big problem. We can't do it out of our own strength. One of my kids said one day, I'm going to be a good person. I can do it myself. I kind of chuckled about that. And the other one jumped up and says, wow. Now I'm confused. The other one said, you can't do it as I can't do it either. So I have kids in my household who think they can be good persons out of themselves, and I know some, and they know of themselves that they can't. Now try not to say one bad word, not have a bad thought, don't hurt anybody with your actions or words. Try it for just 1 week, or just try it for one day. And if you're honest to yourself, you know you can't. I can't. I fail about every day. Here's the good news we've been waiting for. God provided a solution for our problem that we can't do it out of our own strength. Because Christ paid His penalty for our sins in full, and God is now able to look at us through Christ, perfect atonement. In Hebrews 10:4 we read, for it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. In verse 10, and by that we will have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. We can come to Him through the throne and ask Him for help. Hebrews 4:15 says, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who is in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Philippians 2:13 says, for it is God who works in you both to will and to work for His good pleasure. Sometimes when we really struggle to do the right things, if it's forgiving someone, maybe even our own spouse, or withstanding certain temptations, we have to scream to God and say, I don't want to forgive. I don't want to resist temptations. I'm sick and tired of it, but God, You work in me. The will first, then I want to forgive, that I want to resist sin and obey You, and then also give me the strength to accomplish it, as I'm not capable of either. It may not always work instant, as we're sinful, stubborn humans. But God will hear this prayer and answer it, as He promised to give us the will and works to do it. He has certainly done it a lot in my own life. Sometimes my youngest daughter sits at the stairs grumpy and crying. Eventually I would go and see what the matter is. She continues to cry, and I would ask, like, what's wrong? What's the problem? How can I help? And she continues to cry, and she does it on and on and on at the point where I want to go inside and close the door. And And she knows if she would just tell me what the problem is, then at least I could help. And I know, I see it often what the problem is. Her boot is stuck or she can't open her jacket. But I'll encourage her to ask what she wants so I can help her. I think that's sometimes how it is with God. He sees our problems. He could fix it without us asking, but He encouraged us to come to His throne and ask, and He will give gladly. That's how great our God is. Today we learned what the world and what the Bible has to say what we deserve. We learned that we should not toy with sin nor look prideful down on others, thinking we are good and God is proud of our achievements. That God is merciful and gracious and always willing to receive us if we humble ourselves and repent. And He promised us to give us the will and works, as we can't do it out of our own. This will hopefully encourage those of us who struggle with sin and think, how can God forgive me? For those of us who struggle with being gracious towards others, overlooking our own sins and trespasses, there is hope for us, and I pray that you will run to God daily and ask Him to work in you the will and the works to do His good pleasure. Amen. I'm going to pray and close in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this morning. We heard the message about these two brothers, and you see each one of us, and I ask you that you work in our lives, that you do the work and you grow us, that we can be compassionate to one another, that you show us our own sins, that we realize and grow how much you've forgiven us, that we can grow in that and not only and grasp that, and then start to have grace and mercy on everybody around us. Amen. The benediction, we read Romans 15, 5 and 6. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another in according with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You're dismissed.